Please rise in body and spirit and join me in call to worship. Come and find the quiet center in the crowded life we lead. Find the room for hope to enter. Find the frame we're afraid. Clear the chaos and the clutter. Clear our eyes that we can see.
All the things that
no real matter. Be at peace and simply be. Thank you.
Lord be with you.
And
also with you. Welcome to worship on this fine morning. We gather together today to remember that serenity is possible. It is not a passive act, but it is possible. So we gather together as one body to hear the stories, to sing the song, to pray the prayers that remind us if we are listening, if we are attentive, then serenity can be ours. And we can live and move and have our being in serenity. In that spirit, in that audacious spirit, please turn to your neighbor and give them the peace that comes with Jesus Christ.
Today's scripture reading comes from the Gospel of Mark, which was written to Christians facing prosecution in Rome. It is filled with stories of how Jesus overcome the powers of darkness, including in this story a fierce storm on the Sea of Galilee that threatened to drown the disciples. May we hear these words, the promise of God to still the storm in our lives. Please rise in body or in spirit for the gospel reading. On that day, when evening had come, he said to them, "Let us go across to the other side." And leaving the crowd behind, they took him with them in the boat, just as he was. Other boats were with him. A great windstorm arose, and the waves beat into the boat, so the boat was already being swamped. But he was in the stern, asleep on the cushion. And they woke him up and said to him, "Teacher, do you not care that we are perishing?" He woke up and rebuked the winds and said to the sea, "Peace, be still." Then the wind ceased, and there was a dead calm. He said to them, "Why are you afraid? Have you still no faith?" And they were filled with great awe and said to one another, "Who then is this that even the winds and the sea obey him?" This is what the Spirit is saying to the church.
We invite our children to come forward now. Good morning, everybody. Good morning. We have some new friends today. Okay. And we have some old friends who are back from Colorado. Okay, we can just have a seat here. We've got a few more coming forward. But we'll start talking as they come forward. They can hear. Here comes Cora. So we just heard about a pretty wild boat trip that Jesus had with some friends, didn't we? You heard that story? Pretty big boat trip. They were out on the Sea of Galilee and some big wind came up and big waves. I wonder if any of you have ever been in a boat. Have any of you ever been in a boat? Yes, some have, and I know Cora has. And you've been in a canoe. Oh, sure. Well, you've all been out on a variety of boats. I like going out on boats, too. Generally, it's my kayaks. And, you know, when you're out in the water and there's no wind and there's no waves, it's so peaceful. But, you know, sometimes when there's waves, it's really fun, too. But no matter what, we always want to be safe. So one thing we always wear in a boat is a life jacket, right? You know what this is, huh? Let's see what it looks like on me here in church. I normally don't wear a sport coat when I go kayaking, but I always wear this when I'm kayaking, and if I'm going in really rough water and might flip over on a river or something, gotta have a helmet. Let's see. Well, often I'll use a spray skirt, so water doesn't fill up the boat. Sometimes, if I know it's going to be wild, I'll bring a radio so I can call for help if need be. In my pockets, I've got all kinds of things. I've got a flare and whistles. It's really good to be ready no matter what comes. Oh, one more thing. You know, it's really good to know how to swim if you're out in a boat, right? So, some of you, I bet, have taken some swimming lessons, and I bet you'll be taking them if you haven't, but that's always a good thing. So, you know, God is always with us, and God wants us to be safe, but God also wants us to plan and use our head and be sensible and make sure we have the right safety equipment And until you get to be old enough, make sure you're with your parents or another adult, all kinds of things to be safe. So, yes, Lucas? You've kayaked in a pool, but a big pool. Okay. Are we ready to pray? Let's pray together. Thank you, Lord, for the coolness and beauty of water. For the chance to swim and boat and to be safe. Amen. Okay, well, let's go up together.
I wish to begin my sermon today by saying that I am very grateful. I am very grateful that we are no longer separating families at the U.S.-Mexico border. Amen? And I ask you to join me in praying for the 2,300 children already separated for a speedy reunion. I'm a grandfather. It's pretty obvious when you stop and talk to me and I show you pictures. I'm a grandfather and I can't imagine this happening to precious Maria or Elodie. As a follower of Christ, I know there is evil in the world, and at times it can seem overwhelming. Amen? It's then that I find hope in the Church of Jesus Christ that literally keeps me afloat. The World Council of Churches was born in the dark days of World War II. And in that tumultuous time, when many in the world were despairing about our future, the church chose as its symbol, the World Council of Churches chose as its symbol, a boat. Because indeed, we are all in the same boat. Amen? And for its mast, it chose the cross. For that is our peace and our serenity. Amen? Welcome aboard, my friends, for the journey with Scripture and the journey out into the world. Let us pray. Gracious God, we thank you for the stories of Scripture that bring us to the place of understanding what you wish for us and for the world. Bless us as we seek your serenity, even in the midst of the storm. For we pray this in Christ's name, and all the people said, Amen. Tim read from Mark's Gospel, which is the Gospel we're reading in this liturgical and lectionary season. Mark prominently displays a battle between good and evil throughout its pages. Jesus is often called upon to exorcise demons or cast out evil spirits. It's no wonder this is the theme for the Gospel of Mark, for it was written to Christians who were in Rome. And enduring in that seventh decade of that new period, terrible persecution, when the ruler of the empire, Nero, concerned only with his own power and his own prestige, accused the Christians of setting fire to Rome. A fire which, incidentally, he may have started to clear a broad swath of the city to pave the way for his grandiose building projects. The gospel writer fully understands the question we are asked in our baptismal liturgy and in the reception of new members. This question: do you accept the freedom and power God gives you to resist evil, injustice, and oppression in whatever forms it presents itself? If so, say, I do. In the beginning of the chapter of today's scripture lesson, Jesus is teaching the people who are gathered by the lakeshore there at the Sea of Galilee. And when the crowd presses too closely, Jesus steps into the boat of one of the fishermen. And so, in a sense, the boat becomes his pulpit. With his teaching at an end later in the day and evening coming on, Jesus suggested to the disciples, let's go over to the other side. Now, there are reasons for the suggestion. The press of the crowds, sometimes the difficulty of Jesus to find any serenity and peace in the moment, and the desire to carry the message yet to another shore. But there was reluctance on the part of the disciples. For the Sea of Galilee was notorious for its storms. It was 8 miles wide and about 12 miles from north to south. It was notorious in the detail that it was set 750 feet below sea level, the second lowest lake in the world besides the Dead Sea. And its eastern edge rises to mountainous terrain, and it's really cupped with hills all around. Great winds come over at a moment's notice and stir the waves into a tumult. Well, we know in Michigan that smaller bodies of water are notorious for sudden squalls and winds. Even on the larger scale of the Great Lakes, storms can happen there more ferocious than the ocean. So Jesus and his disciples push off, along with some other boats, it says, for the farther shore. And in the midst of the crossing, under the mantle of darkness, a great windstorm descends, whipping up the waves to towering heights and threatening to swamp their boat. Mark, would you share with us a famous painting? Rembrandt, the famous Dutch painter of the 17th century, presented the story on canvas, and for me, powerfully captures the moment. Fearing for their lives, the disciples seek the help of their Lord. Jesus, in the midst of the storm, is sleeping, we hear in the scripture. Rembrandt captures the moment when they awaken Jesus with the plaintive question, "Don't you care that we are about to perish?" It's a deeply relevant and personal question, which I believe all of us have uttered at one time or another. When we learn that a loved one's diagnosis has turned so much worse, when we thought we had more time and suddenly things have changed and we're wondering where God is in the midst of it, when a job that we've been hoping for doesn't come our way because of circumstances that don't seem fair or just, and we wonder where God is in leading and calling us, when we wake up in the morning and we hear news or read of what's happening on our southern border or other places in our world that seems to knock the props from under the principles of our nation, we wonder, where is God and where is what God wants in the world? And it sometimes seems that our Lord is sleeping. Rembrandt, sensing that universal anxiety that all of us feel at one time or another, painted himself into the scene. He's the man holding on to the rope in the lower center section, and he's looking out at you. Because you're in the boat as well, aren't you? Thank you, Mark, for sharing that painting with us. And Jesus rebukes the wind and the waves. The Greek word for what Jesus did in the rebuking is the same word used when Jesus casts out demons. It's this strong, clear sign that good will triumph no matter what the storm. Amen? Peace. Be still. The simplicity, the brevity of the command. Peace. Be still. There's a wonderful parallel in the Old Testament with the opening words of Genesis, wherein God brings order out of the primordial chaos. You remember that it speaks of how in the beginning, when God created the heavens and the earth, there was this chaotic water, there was this darkness over the face of the deep. And what are the very first words of God in Scripture? What are the very first words of God in Scripture? You perhaps remember them. Let there be light. Can you say that with me? Let there be light. The disciples are being given a very clear sign that with Jesus, we stand on a stronger side. Amen? Good will prevail over evil. Remember the question again from those baptismal and membership vows. Do you accept the freedom and the power that God gives you to resist evil, injustice, and oppression in whatever forms they present themselves? And let us answer together, I do. I do. John's gospel phrases it in a different yet powerful way. In the fifth verse of the first chapter, John intones, the light has come into the world, and the darkness has never overcome it. Let me say that again. The light has come into the world, and the darkness has never overcome it. Amen? The Apostle Paul echoes this in his letter to the Christians in Rome when he writes, I am certain that there is nothing in death or in life, nothing in powers or principalities, nothing in things present or things to come that will ever be able to separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus our Lord. What an assurance. What a powerful affirmation about the love of God in the world. Well, back in the boat, the disciples could sure benefit from the same command, peace, be still. In fact, come to think of it, so could I. And perhaps so could you. To hear the Master say to you, as we're in this boat together, peace, be still. At the conclusion of Mark's story, Jesus turns to his awestruck disciples and gently chides them by saying, why are you afraid? Why are you afraid? Why do you persist in having so little faith? The story ends with them saying half out loud, who is this? Who is this that even the winds and waves obey him? Well, this is one of my favorite stories in the gospel. Although I know as I enter my fifth year among you as a pastor serving you, you've probably heard me say that about more than one or two or three or a dozen scripture passages. There is so much good in the scripture for us. Amen. Perhaps it's because I've loved Rembrandt from an early age, being drawn to his work, his biblical themes, his talent of mixing light and shadow and focusing us and our attention on what it is that perhaps is most important. And then the size of his canvases, the one that Mark had shown you, was 5 feet tall and 4 feet wide. That's a lot of brush strokes. It was Rembrandt's only seascape. It hung in Boston at Isabel Stewart Gardner's famous museum. She was a wealthy Bostonian more than a century ago, a collector of fine art. She purchased that painting and included it in her home along with hundreds of other works of art, and then bequeathed that home to the public with the request that the art stay where it is and never be sold so that the public could always enjoy it. And they did. For decades and decades and decades, until that fateful night on August 18, 1990, when two men posing as Boston policemen entered the museum on the pretense of an investigation. They handcuffed and bound the two college-age students who were serving as security, and they stole $500 million worth of art, including that painting. For many of us, the paintings are priceless. Today, you can go to the museum and you can see its frame of that Rembrandt masterpiece hung on the wall and empty. The title of Rembrandt's painting is Christ in the Storm on the Sea of Galilee, and I love that, and his theological and biblical insight. Christ in the storm. Christ in the storm. And so imagine right now the storm that you might be facing, or that we collectively face in community or nation or world. Think about that storm and then say to yourself, Christ is in that storm. Christ is in the boat with us, my friends. In our grief and loss, Christ is there. In our illness and struggle and pain, Christ is there. In our uncertainties, in our despair, in our despondency, Christ is there in the boat with us. I've entitled my sermon, Recovering the Lost Art of Serenity. Oh, it gave a nod to the lost art of Rembrandt's missing masterpiece. And coincidentally, happened to relate to a fascinating story of lost art recently presented by the Kalamazoo Institute of Art just next door. The presentation was entitled, Packed in a Trunk, the Lost Art of Edith Lake Wilkinson. My wife and I attended the program, and were taken by this poignant documentary telling how Edith Wilkinson, a groundbreaking artist from the 1920s, was marginalized because she was a gay woman committed to a mental institution by a relative who plundered her inheritance and packed away her artwork away in a trunk where it sat for years until discovered by a relative. Well, we may not find the lost Rembrandt or recover lost art in an attic trunk. However, I believe we have lost art to recover, and that is the lost art of serenity. Amen? You and I prize peaceful moments, don't we? Dan was talking to the children about kayaking or canoeing, and I can see that there are so many ways in which, if you're there in a quiet and beautiful setting, that is a place you'd like to stay for the peace that we find. It's amazing how peace and words of peace can kind of calm us, as indeed Jesus' words did in the storm. I have the pleasure, when Dan is busy with other ministries, I have the pleasure of going upstairs to our children's chapel with First Care, along with my monkey Zach, and don't say anything about who his uncle is, please. But one of the ways in which I love that experience is that it's become a tradition for me when I do that with children here or in the previous parish where I regularly did such a chapel with our childcare program, is I ended each of our times of singing with something very quiet. The teachers appreciated that. than something that had us jumping up and down. But I ended with a song about peace. Peace before me, peace behind me, peace under my feet, peace within me, peace over me, let all around me be peace. We do it a couple times. And amazingly, I see some of the children start to yawn. I'll do it a couple times and I may lose some of you today, but I think there is something about our yearning and our desire for peace, amen? To be able to prize and to find that serenity. And yet with turmoil storming around us, it's easy to bewail our situation or even cry out to God, "Don't you care, we are about to perish." And yet in the midst of the storm, Jesus is sleeping. How is that possible? Obviously, the theological point of this is not that God doesn't care about what's happening to us and is indifferent to our situation. That's poor theology and biblical interpretation if we arrive at that place at all. God cares deeply about the world, deeply about you and me. But that deep care of God doesn't display itself in panic. It doesn't display itself in terror. It doesn't display itself in despair. Jesus had a deep trust within that more than counterbalanced the winds and waves without. That's what Paul meant when he wrote in that letter to the Romans who were suffering at the hands of authorities, when he wrote and said, "We are more than conquerors." So how can you and I be more than conquerors? For you see, it's not just about a battle. It's about inside, what we have inside. And so I'd like for you, since we've often, and Julie's helped us with this as well in emerging and in this worship, to be able to do a breath prayer. That's where you breathe out and breathe in. And I'd like to just encourage you to just take some deep breaths with me. Breathe out and breathe in. And now I'd like you, as you breathe out, to just breathe out worry. Breathe out worry. And then inhale, trust. Trust. And let's do that a couple times. Worry. Trust. Worry. Trust. Yes. And we are led by a child. For I'd like to conclude by a story from Thursday's Gazette about a father who went with his 5-year-old Nora on Father's Day to Muskegon State Park. And as they were walking the dunes, they came upon some driftwood that had been arranged purposely in the form of a swastika. The father thought to turn away or to not even look at it or deal with it, but he took a moment and he thought this could be an opportunity, and he and Nora went over, and then he said to her, "This is a swastika." She's not quite sure, but then he said, "This is what the Nazis used as a symbol." She nodded. She knew they had been to Sound of Music, and she knew they were the bad guys. And so together, they rearranged the driftwood from the swastika to form the name of Nora's baby sister, Ari. And so God calls us in the serenity of our heart to rearrange all the signs of injustice, evil, and depression, and whatever forms they present themselves, in a way that speaks of the message of the cross and its good news. Let us pray. Gracious God, I thank you for the voices of children in our midst and for your voice. Peace, be still, so that we can take from this place an assurance of your love and care for us and for the wider world. and that we can know that good triumphs. Peace, be still. And all the people said, Amen.
The peace of Christ makes fresh my heart. That's what we just sung. The peace of Christ makes fresh my heart. I want you to just imagine that moment in the boat when Jesus stood up and stilled that storm. Imagine the calm. The scriptures say it's a dead calm. That is the peace that we must return to again and again. Serenity is not passive because we must return. We must seek, we must find again and again. And so let us enter in again to that breath, to that stillness, to that prayer of silence that is so full. Let us pray together. God, grant us serenity to accept the things that we cannot change, courage to change the things that we can, and the wisdom to know the difference. Allow us to live one day at a time, enjoying one moment at a time, accepting hardships as the pathway to peace, taking as Christ did this sinful world as it is, not as we would have it, trusting that Christ will make things right. If we will but surrender to Christ, so that we may be reasonably happy in this life and supremely happy with Christ forever and ever in the next. O God of time, Prince of Peace, we need you to teach us by your example. We need you to steady us by your presence. We pray, O God, that you will be close beside those who are trying to prepare for an uncertain, perhaps an even frightening future. We ask that you would call out to those who don't know where to turn anymore, and that you would save them, that you would pull them up and save them from their despair. We pray that you might guide those who are facing confusing decisions between imperfect options. We pray for those who feel like the storm will not stop. And we ask you to rescue them from feeling inadequate and guilty before they collapse into hopelessness. For all, God, we pray that you would renew us in your grace and freedom. For we are about ready to set out on another week, and we need to know that your grace, your freedom, is ours, and ours to give, and ours to make possible. We ask, God, that you would be with our world leaders, and that you would help them to find ways of compassion. We pray that you would bring strength and healing to Hannah Boley. We pray for the loss of Antoine Rose. We ask that your presence be near his family and the Pittsburgh community. We pray for the safety of young black men. May we be resistors of evil, injustice, and oppression in whatever forms they may present themselves. And let this not just be words upon our lips, but actions within our lives. We pray that you will bless the beginning of the Kids Adventure program as they gather here tomorrow morning. We pray for Hungary and Italy, who are also struggling with compassion for immigrants. We pray for the endurance of a relationship and that the pain within one's body would subside. We pray for a grandma and grandpa who were in a car accident. We ask for peace and serenity for a son, Dakota, who's going through some troubling times. We pray for the dream team and that you might enlighten them and give them vision as they study the needs of people in the community and that they might find solutions for the ending of poverty and the lack of resources. We ask that you would be with Matthew and Emily. We pray for continuing recovery for Tim, who's been injured in a bicycle accident. Bring peace to a daughter who's waiting for a diagnosis. And we pray for strength and courage for a granddaughter, employment for a son. And we ask that you'd bring peace to a son who finds himself in a mess. And we pray that actions within court will be sorted out. O Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayers. Hear our prayers that come to our hearts and our minds easily, and then hear our prayers that are within the deepest recesses of our souls and our spirits, and we don't know how to put words to them. But bring them out of us in love, in compassion. Help us each and every moment of our lives to pour more love into this world. If that is our simple mission for the moment and for the day, make it ours. In that spirit, we pray together the words that Christ taught us. Our God, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. We have been given this time together to find serenity and peace. It is a gift. And so let us graciously offer up our hearts that are filled with serenity. Let us offer up our gifts, our tithes, that then can create serenity for others. Let us give fully as we are able. Thank you.
Join me now in declaring our gifts. Lord of all, we come to offer our praise, thanksgiving, for stilling the storm, for the calming of the sea. Bless these gifts we offer, that they may bring your peace to the world. And may it begin with us. In Christ's name we pray. Amen.
Right after worship, Pastor Steve is going to be offering a tour of the church. This is for new members and for anyone who might be curious to check out our church building and learn a little bit of history as you all go. So if you are interested, meet right after or shortly after worship at the welcome desk. Please check out our announcements. We have still so much going on, as always, in this vital church throughout summer. So as I mentioned in prayers, the CAP program is starting tomorrow morning. They may still have some needs that you could meet, but they could certainly use your prayers. And there's softball, there's basketball, there's a mission for the month, and there is also a town hall meeting on gun violence prevention. So if you will please make yourself active whenever and however you can. Let us sing ourselves out with courage into this world.
And we in the same boat, may we indeed live the words we've just sung through waves and clouds and storms. God gently clears the way. Wait for God's time. So shall this night soon end in joyous day. May indeed the presence and power of God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, Creator Christ, and presence with us, go with you and lift you up and send you forth. And all the people said, Amen. Amen.